Students, in previous module we have studied about radioactivity and about different facilities from which radioactive wastes are generated. In this module we will be concentrating on the treatment and disposal of radioactive waste. Radioactive wastes are produced during their production as well as during their use. So whosoever is involved in the production and use of radioactive materials must know about different options which are available for the treatment and disposal of radioactive waste. As long as these treatment and disposal techniques or methods are not in place, one should not use radioactive materials, because if these options are not available, that time there are chances that radioactive materials may be released in the environment, and when these are released in the environment, they may cause harm to human as well as non-human biota. And you know that how much damage they can do and how long they can exist in the environment, that depends on their half-life. So with this background, the learning objectives of this module are to understand or to familiarize about different treatment options that are available for radioactive waste treatment, and to learn about various disposal options available for the radioactive waste. Technological steps involved in the radioactive waste management. There are several steps that are involved in the radioactive waste management, and these steps are pretreatment, treatment, conditioning, storage, transportation, and disposal of the radioactive waste. This flowchart diagram shows the technological steps involved in the radioactive waste management. First of all, when the waste is generated, after that we should go for minimization of the waste, for the collection of waste, and for the segregation of waste. About collection of waste, you have studied in the previous module, and you have also studied about the segregation of waste in the previous module. In the segregation, radioactive waste is segregated into two classes, short-lived radionuclides and long-lived radionuclide. Here, short-lived radionuclide means those are having smaller half-life, and long-lived radionuclides are those radionuclides which are having longer half-life. These steps come under pretreatment of the radioactive waste. The short-lived radioactive waste are usually stored for their decay, and after the decay, these may be disposed either in the sewers or may be disposed in the landfills. Long-lived radionuclides or radioactive waste that is separated during the pretreatment is treated, and in the treatment mainly we go for volume reduction. The different methods that are used for the volume reduction you have already studied in the previous module. Next step is conditioning. In the conditioning, we go for the immobilization and packaging. This step is very, very important, because if radioactive waste are not immobilized, that time there are chances that radioactive waste may be leaked to the environment. At that time, it may enter into food chain, into our water bodies, etc., etc. Next step is the storage. Here in the storage, for long-lived radioactive waste, we go for interim storage. Interim storage is done before their final disposal. Next step is transportation. Transportation is done through different vehicles. Whenever radioactive waste is transported, due care should be taken that there is no leakage of the radioactive material during the transportation, as well as there no emission of radiation, so that environment and human life can be protected. And final step is the disposal. And in the disposal, disposal may be near surface or this may be in the underground repository. So, now in this module, we shall be studying treatment and disposal options which are available for the treatment of radioactive waste. Let me discuss the different options which are available for the treatment of radioactive waste. We know that radioactive waste may be present in the solid form, in liquid form, as well as in the gaseous form. So, we have different options for solid waste treatment, different options for radioactive waste treatment, and different options for gaseous radioactive waste. So, we will be discussing them one by one. Treatment of solid radioactive waste. Before treatment, the solid waste are segregated into combustible, compactable, and non-compactable forms. The purpose of solid waste treatment is to reduce the volume of waste and make it suitable for storage and transportation. This process includes several steps. First step is shredding. Shredding reduces wide space and is particularly effective when waste are compacted. Second step is crushing. Crushing is used for size reduction of friable solids like glass, concrete, ceramics, etc. Then next step is cutting. Cutting is done for items like metals or plastics. Size is reduced for storage, transportation or incineration. Cutting is done either in the dry state inside cells or with conventional tools under water. Plasma jets, laser torches or explosive fuse cutting are also practiced. Next step is compaction. By the process of compaction, volume of waste is reduced and concentrated. By this process, volume is reduced by a factor of 3 to 10. Suppose we have 100 kilogram of radioactive waste, that may be reduced to 30 to 10 kilogram. Conventional and super compactors are used for compaction process. Conventional compactors are used mainly for plastic, paper, absorbent material and clothes that are contaminated with radioactivity. Super compactors are used for the compaction of metal pipes, wood, etc. Incineration. Incineration is a process where the waste is combusted at higher temperature in the range of 800 to 1100 degree Celsius. By the process of incineration, volume of the waste is reduced by 90% and generally the end products produced during incineration include ash, carbon dioxide, water vapors, sulfur dioxide, nitric oxide and HCl gases. Since incineration reduces the volume of waste by 90%, it minimizes the requirement of the land for disposal of waste. Incineration can be used for the reduction of solid as well as liquid radioactive waste. But incineration process is having its own limitation. This process requires off-gas filtering system. Pre-treatment is required for incineration, and this pre-treatment that is required for incineration include thickening and dewatering of liquid waste. High cost, as the process is energy intensive because this incineration is carried out at a temperature of 18 to 1100 degree Celsius. And emission control equipments are also required for particulate matter, sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides, and other products of incomplete oxidation. So, there is a problem of air pollution control. Volume of secondary waste generation is very high during the incineration. Treatment of aqueous liquid radioactive waste. Several methods are used for the treatment of liquid radioactive waste. These methods include ion exchange or sorption, chemical precipitation, evaporation, etc. Let me discuss them one by one. Ion exchange or sorption. This process replaces cations or anions between an insoluble solid matrix containing ionizable polar groups and a liquid solution. When the ionic groups are negatives, the exchange will involve cations, and when they are positively charged, they involve anions. Ion exchange is a reversible process, and the ion exchangers or ion exchange resins can be regenerated. If the ion exchanger is saturated, then they are replaced with new resins. The old exchange resins are then treated as radioactive waste. Materials used as ion exchange resins include natural ion exchangers and synthetic materials. Natural ion exchangers include clays, zeolites, cellulose, charcoals, collagen, etc. Whereas synthetic materials include zeolites, hydrous oxide gels of metals, or organic resins formed by highly polymerized cross-linked hydrocarbons containing ionic groups like sulfonic acid, carboxylic acid, amino groups, etc. Then chemical precipitation process. Chemical precipitation process is used for removing waste with low and intermediate level radioactivity produced from fuel reprocessing facilities, research laboratories, and power stations. It is a simple economical treatment process with potential to treat large volumes of liquid effluents. This process requires pretreatment such as pH alterations, oxidization of organic contaminants, decomposition of complex species, alteration of ionic species, etc. Evaporation process is process of concentrating the waste and reduce large volumes of waste to smaller volumes. Used for high, intermediate and low level waste effluents. Performed in commercial evaporation units. The limitation of this process are the process is unsuitable for waste effluents containing large concentrations of inactive salts. The process is expensive due to high energy requirement that is required for the evaporation. Sometimes explosion may occur due to organic compounds present in the effluent. Treatment of radioactive organic liquids. Liquids, solvents, oils and other biological fluids generated from nuclear research and medical centers are treated by under this category. The waste can be radioactive biohazard or chemical hazard. The purpose of this process is to reduce the volume of radioactive waste so that it can be safely stored, transported, conditioned and disposed. The process used for treating organic liquids are discussed in the following section. Different processes used for the treatment of radioactive organic liquid include incineration, wet oxidation, acidization, and distillation. Incineration is the same process as we have discussed earlier. Now, let we come to wet oxidation. Wet air oxidation is similar to incineration process, but the temperature used in wet oxidation is lower or lesser as compared to incineration. Wet oxidation process involves the oxidation of the pollutant through injection of an oxidizing agent inside the reactor. The oxidizing agents used include hydrogen peroxide, activated sodium persulfate, ozone, Phantom's reagent, Phantom reagent is hydrogen peroxide with an iron catalyst. The end products produced during the wet oxidation include carbon dioxide, water, oxygen, and small proportions of non-toxic ions, salts, and acids. Waste such as organic contents of radioactive waste from ion exchange resins and foams, cellulogic waste, and liquid scintillation waste are treated using wet oxidation process. Another process is acid digestion. Acid digestion is an oxidative destruction technology for organic liquids, waste like hexanes, oils, and organic constituents of mixed waste such as cellulose, rubber, polymers, and polymers like polyethylene, polyvinyl chloride, polystyrene, ion exchange resins, etc. During this process, the waste volume is reduced by 20 to 100 times. The process involves the use of acid mixture, generally nitric acid in a phosphoric acid carrier is used as acid mixture. At temperatures and pressure of below 200 degrees Celsius and less than 20 psig, the end product of this process is inorganic constituents and gases. The gases include carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, oxygen, and oxides of nitrogen. Another process is distillation. Distillation is a chemical process by which the substances are separated from a liquid mixture by selective evaporation and condensation. This process provides high decontamination efficiency for radioactive waste. It is a volume reduction technique used for treating liquids generated from scintillation counters and solvents from other equipments. If you come to the advantages of this process, this is a simple process and this is cost effective if solvents that are used are recycled. So, these were the different methods that can be used for the treatment of radioactive waste. Now, let me come to the disposal of radioactive waste. Disposal is the final step in the management of radioactive waste. High level nuclear waste from both commercial reactors and defense industry presents a difficult problem to the scientific community as well as the public. The solutions to high end nuclear waste are still debatable, both technically as well as ethically. There are several proposals for disposing high level nuclear waste. However, the most favored solution for discarding of radioactive waste is sorting out radioactive waste from man and biosphere to avoid unwarranted radiation exposure. Thus, the radioactive waste is confined or isolated from the biosphere in the repositories. The location of repositories is decided based on the longevity and concentration of the radionuclide present in the waste. The repository of radioactive waste can be near the surface or in the deep geological formations. Options for disposal of radioactive waste. There are several options that are available for the disposal of radioactive waste, and these options include deep geological repositories, underwater disposal. Underwater disposal is mainly limited to ocean dumping is another technique. In seabed burial, we can have sub-seabed disposal and subductive waste disposal. Another approach can be transforming radioactive waste to non-radioactive stable waste. Another approach can be dispatching of radioactive waste to the sun. But this is for the attention of all that these options require serious studies and technical assessment before their use for the management or disposal of radioactive waste. Let me discuss these options one by one. Geological disposal of radioactive waste. For handling long-lived radioactive waste, disposal in form of geological disposal in deep geological formation, whether under continental crust or under seabed, has been recognized since 1957. Deep geological disposal involves introducing waste packages in underground structure dug in a impermeable geological medium having favorable properties in terms of its geological stability, hydrogeology, geochemistry, and response to mechanical and thermal stress. The chosen medium must avoid areas of exceptional interest in terms of exploitable underground resources, and the structures must be located at least 200 to 300 meter below the ground surface to avoid the effects of erosion and human intrusion. The deep geological sites offer a natural isolation system that is stable over thousands of years to hold long-lived radioactive waste. This figure shows the geological disposal of radioactive waste. Low-level radioactive waste is normally disposed in near surface facilities or old mines. High-level radioactive waste is disposed in host rocks that are crystalline, like granite, gneiss, or argillaceous clays, or salty or tuff. In countries where high-level radioactive waste is minimal, provisional storage facility is provided. Underwater disposal. Underwater disposal of spent nuclear fuel. Spent nuclear fuel is that fuel that is produced at the nuclear power plants. Waste is done by two methods: dumping containers of radioactive waste in the ocean and sub-seabed disposal. The main reason of underwater disposal of spent nuclear fuel is to isolate the radioactive waste from human contact and the environment for a long period, enough to avoid release of harmful radiations. This figure shows underwater disposal of radioactive waste. The industrialized countries of the world, example United States, France, Great Britain, etc., for numerous years opted dumping into the ocean as the least expensive method for disposal of radioactive waste. Around 112,000 containers of nuclear waste at 30 locations in the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans have been dumped by USA. The US government banned or stopped sea dumping of spent nuclear fuel in the 1980s, although this practice has been prohibited by nearly all the countries with nuclear programs. Russia, which presently controls 60% of the world's nuclear reactor, continues to dispose of its nuclear waste into the oceans. Sub-seabed disposal. Seabed disposal is dissimilar from sea dumping, which doesn't involve separation of low-level radioactive waste within geological strata. The deep ocean's floor is a part of a large tectonic plate situated 5 kilometers below the sea surface, covered by hundreds of meters of thick sedimentary soft clay. These sections are desert-like, sporting almost no life. Subseabed disposal is complex and involves two associated methods: creating a repository with a possible for retrieval of spent nuclear fuel everlasting burial, transmutation of high-level radioactive waste. Transmutational devices consists of a hybrid of a subcritical nuclear reactor and an accelerator of charged particles to destroy radioactivity by neutrons. Destroy may not be the proper word. What is affected is that the fission fragments can be transmuted by neutron capture and beta decay to produce stable nucleides. Transmutation of actinides involves several competing processes like neutron-induced fission, neutron capture, and radioactive decay. The large number of neutrons produced in the separation reaction by the accelerator are used for destroying the radioactive material kept in the subcritical reactor. The scheme has not so far been demonstrated to be practical and cost effective. Subductive waste disposal method. It is the latest technology in radioactive waste disposal. It is the single feasible means of disposing radioactive waste that guarantees non-return of the relegated material to the biosphere. Simultaneously, it affords inaccessibility to abolished weapons material. The principle involved is the elimination of material from the biosphere faster than it can return. It is considered that the safest, the most sensible, the most economical, the most stable long term, the most environmentally benign, the most completely obvious places to get rid of nuclear waste, high level waste or low level waste, is in the deep oceans that cover 70% of the planet. Subduction is a process whereby one tectonic plate slides beneath another and is ultimately reabsorbed into the mantle. The subductive waste disposal method forms a high level radioactive waste repository in a subducting plate so that the waste will be carried beneath the earth's crust, where it will be diluted and dispersed through the mantle. The rate of subduction of a plate in one of the world's slowest subduction zones is 2.1 centimeter annually. This is faster than the rate of diffusion of radionuclides through the turbidite sediments that would overlay a repository constructed in accordance with this method. The subducting plate is naturally predestined for consumption in the earth's mantle. The subducting plate is continuously renewed as it originating oceanic ridge. The slow movement of the plate would seal any vertical fractures over a repository at the interface between the subducting plate and the overriding plate. Another option is the solar option. This option is proposed that surplus weapons, plutonium and other highly concentrated waste might be placed in the Earth's orbit and then accelerated so that waste would drop into the sun. Although this is theoretically possible, it involves vast technical development and extremely high cost as compared to other means of waste disposal. Robust containment would be required to ensure that no waste would be released in the event of failure of the space transport system. This table shows different kind of radioactive waste and their handling. In this table, the data or the quantities are given of different type of radioactive waste that may be produced from a 1000 megawatt nuclear power station. So, from this, low level waste are produced from the mainly during the maintenance, and about 50 cubic meter per year of the waste is generated by 1000 megawatt station. As far as disposal method is concerned, low level radioactive waste is packed in drums and shallow burial. Intermediate level radioactive waste is produced during different operations, and about 50 cubic meter per year of the waste is produced by 1000 megawatt station. Generally, this waste is packed in drums and shallow burial. High level waste, its origin is radioactive products extracted from spent nuclear fuel. Generally, 3 meter cube per year of high level radioactive waste is produced by a 1000 megawatt station. This high level radioactive waste is vitrified, packed in capsules, and underground repository is used for their disposal. Dear students, IAEA has produced a book that is related with the handling and disposal of radioactive waste generated from different facilities. I have shown the cover page of that book here in this slide. This book is available in free from the website of IAEA. So, if you are interested to know more about the treatment and disposal of radioactive waste, you are suggested to download this book and go through this book. You will find lot of interesting information in that book that is beyond the scope of this lecture. So, to summarize this module, in this module, we have learnt about different steps that are used for the management of radioactive waste, and then we have discussed different radioactive waste treatment methods and we have that are used for the solid as well as liquid radioactive waste, and we also discussed different methods or different options that are available for the disposal of radioactive waste. In last, I will again suggest that the producer or generator of radioactive waste must know about their radioactive waste, and they must have all the treatment and disposal facility that are required for the treatment and disposal of radioactive waste before making their production and their use. Thank you.